Hello, everyone. Welcome. Unfortunately, fortunately, we have Joanie Kleypas here with us. Unfortunately, we can't see her because of some technological malfunction on Zoom, but she's here. Looks like she has a great seminar prepared. So Joanie's a marine scientist at the National Center for Atmospheric Research, and she investigates how rising carbon dioxide is affecting marine ecosystems. She's been heavily involved in the topic of ocean acidification since the late 90s, and has served on multiple national and international committees to help define and tackle the problem, including co-author of the National Academy of Sciences report, Ocean Acidification, and contributing author on the topic of ocean acidification in the IPCC Fifth Assessment Report. She's also given multiple briefings and testimony to the U.S. Congress on the topic of marine ecosystem and climate change. Joanie uses a combination of data analysis and modeling to understand coral reef response to climate change with the goal to inform conservation strategies that ensure coral reef survival through this century. She obtained a PhD from James Cook University as a Fulbright Scholar to Australia, where she conducted a reef coring program to examine the history of reef growth since the last glacial maximum and determine why some reefs grow well in some areas but not in others. So welcome, Joanie.
Thanks, Peter. I'm going to share my screen now.
Great.
And get started. Okay, can everyone see that all right?
Oh, we can see you now.
You can. All right.
Yeah. And I'll turn off my video and turn off my...
I came back. All right. I'm going to be... try to be quick on this. I have a lot to say. It says 71 slides on my screen, but I'm not showing 71 slides. There's a lot of stuff at the end that I put in just in case there's questions. But first, I want to just say thanks to Peter and Natalie. Been friends with them for a long time, since when they were at NCAR, and they're sure you all know they're fantastic people, and I know they're fantastic professors. So I was really excited when they invited me to come speak with you guys, because I've always wanted to come up there to visit. And I'm sorry I can't be there in person, but at least we have Zoom to keep us all connected on this. And I also want to wish all of you well. I know this is a stressful time for people, and particularly for a lot of students. I hope all your families are good. And this is just the way we have to move forward. And I look forward to when we can all drink a lot of beers and pound the table on this. Okay, so let's get going. Even though Peter talked a lot about my work in acidification, I'm actually not going to talk about that today. And the reason is because, as the title suggests, it's temperature that's killing off the coral reefs faster than anything. Acidification is rough on them as well, particularly in their ability to recover in terms of larval recruitment. But today I'm going to talk just a lot about how temperature is affecting them and what we can do about it. And so we have kind of a choice for our future. And this is sort of the bottom line. And this is what drives and motivates me. On the left, we have beautiful reefs. This is what the Great Barrier Reef looked like when I was there doing my PhD. And on the right is what happens when all of the corals die and the ecosystem becomes bio-eroded and disappears. So we do have a choice about which direction we're going, and there's things we can do to try to prevent that image on the right. And so my talk is going to focus on four different things. The trajectory towards coral reef collapse, I'll just briefly explain what's happened in the past, talk about future projections, and then talk about some solutions, some innovations to how we can keep coral reefs around. And then, you know, we don't just identify solutions, we have to identify where we can do that, where we can apply those solutions. And the last part is a lot of what I'm doing at NCAR using high resolution modeling. So first, the trajectory of coral reef collapse. So we've all heard how bad it's been, and it has been pretty bad. And how do people track that? Mainly, they just look at the percent coral cover over time. So on the left-hand side, you can see, again, a very healthy coral reef. And the axis, the y-axis, is the percent coral cover on particular reefs. And you can see that both of those lines, the purple for Indo-Pacific and the blue for the Caribbean region, they're both declining a lot. And those declines have been due to a number of things. On the right-hand side, of course, is the picture of a degraded coral reef. But these declines have occurred because of everything from what's shown on the green bars on the axis. Those are mostly biological phenomena, such as crown of thorns starfish invasions, the loss of key species like the sea urchin, diseases which have popped up and begun killing a lot of corals. But you also see along the top part of that gray bar are when we've seen significant bleaching events, coral bleaching events. Those are only increasing, and in fact, we are in a coral bleaching event right now that's affecting a few regions, and particularly the Great Barrier Reef. So when we say we have already lost 30 to 50% of coral reefs, that basically reflects that information I was just showing. What is the percent of coral cover on the reef? So if you look at the red bars, and I hope you can see my cursor, as you move up, that means there's a loss of coral cover, and then they recover, and it goes back down, and then there's another loss, and then it's been creeping up in this sawtooth fashion. So that's just basically, a function of the data that we have been collecting. And where we go in the future, because those data were, we haven't continued that data, or at least it hasn't been synthesized in quite a while, is we know that we're continuing to lose coral reefs mainly because of these coral bleaching events. So that's why we say it's too damn hot already. The photograph on the upper left shows a nice chocolate brown group of corals. Those corals are very healthy. They still have inside their tissues these algae, which we call zooxanthellae. They're endosymbiotic unicellular dinoflagellates that live with inside the coral tissue and do photosynthesis. And that photosynthesis provides the coral with a lot of energy. Some corals, almost all of it, other corals, parts of it. On the right, we see what happens when that coral gets stressed. This is a temperature stress event. The coral is still alive, but you're looking straight through the tissue and seeing the calcium carbonate skeleton underneath the tissue. And that tissue is very transparent when it's lost its algae. So the coral basically looks dead, but is still alive. And then a blow up of those corals, a coral polyp at the bottom, and you can see the algae in the tissues, the greenish part, and then you can see how transparent it is where there are no algae. So this is what's happened in 2016, for example, on the Great Barrier Reef. And I don't know if you guys have seen the movie Chasing Coral, but it documented this process quite well. And it was very true to form. True to the facts in that documentary. The just shows how much of the Great Barrier Reef was impacted. We had certain parts of the reef which lost 67% of the corals due to mortality. It was a really hot year. That happened in 2016, as shown on this left-hand side of the screen. But then the very next year, they bleached again. So one thing we know about corals is that oftentimes they can bleach, but if you give them enough time, they recover and they come back. So they can recover from these bleaching events if they were given enough time. But when they happen annually or even a couple times every decade, it's really hard for them to recover. So the whole goal of looking at this research is to try to figure out how long have they got before they bleach too often to where they can't come back as an ecosystem. And then on the right-hand side shows this sort of current bleaching event that's affecting the Great Barrier Reef right now. So you can see different parts of the reef have been hit each during each one of these events. And this is not a local phenomenon, just on a few places. It's happened globally, all over the place. Just last month in March, I was in Costa Rica. I have a coral restoration project there, and it was severely bleached. We went down there to collect a lot of data. Those corals are recovering, thank God, but it is an example of just how it's affecting all oceans. So I'm going to talk now about where we how we think things will change in the future. And this is based on model projections. And if you are working with Natalie and Peter, I know you guys are probably familiar with this graph. This is from the IPCC report, the AR5 report. And it shows two different scenarios. The representative carbon pathway 8.5, which is the most severe scenario. It's close to where, you know, the pathway we're on right now. And then the RCP 2.6 scenario, which is a much cooler scenario where we have lower emissions. So we all would like to be on that blue curve. But this is what happens to coral reefs in the future. This is work done by Ruben van Hooijdonk and others that shows when we look at coral bleaching and we project it into the future using the same IPCC suite of models, they calculated what year the median year when annual bleaching would occur. Again, annual bleaching is too much. Coral reefs can't survive that, and they can't recover from that. So on the top one, which is the sort of the hopeful scenario where we have low emissions, low temperature increases, 2046, the middle of the century, is the median year. Those little dots on the map that are in black are reflective of that median year, but you can also see a lot of reefs. There's a lot of variability. Some of them will bleach earlier than that, the reds and the yellows, and some will bleach after that, the greens and the blues. You compare that with the RCP 8.5, and it's a little worse. It's not that much worse, but the median year is 2040, and you can see more red and yellow in those graphs. The thing to note about this particular study is they did not allow for the fact that corals are biological and they can adapt to temperature change. And so some colleagues and I have done some more calculations. This is really just with one model, but it kind of illustrates the fact. You also see on the left-hand side, this is sea surface temperature, but just for coral reefs. It's not global surface temperature. It's sea surface temperature for reefs. The gray lines, again, are the RCP 8.5. And the blue is the RCP 2.6. And when we look at that, and we look at the right, we can take those data, and we can calculate looking at whether we have adaptation or not for both of those scenarios. So the solid lines are no adaptation, the same thing that the previous slide had shown. You can see that by the years 2020, 2040, we start seeing a rapid increase in coral bleaching, no matter what trajectory we are on. And that makes sense because when you look at these, I don't know if you can see my cursor, but when you look at these lines, they're very similar right through here, and they diverge later. I mean, this is kind of like, we could call this flattening the curve for temperature, right? So at some point, you're going up, but that you take actions to try to flatten that temperature curve. That flattening of the temperature curve would allow corals to adapt. And that's what see the dashed line. So if we allow corals to adapt, we can see that those trajectories diverge quite a bit. So if we can keep our emissions down and we allow coral reefs to adapt over like a 50-year time period, this is kind of complicated how we calculate this, you can see that the future for reefs is much better for the RCP 2.6 scenario than it is for the RCP 8.5. So we assume and we know that corals can adapt, and we're trying to account for that. So we take that same graph and we say, all right, the next 20 to 30 years is really important for doing what we can do to keep coral reefs around. So we have to keep carbon emissions down. That's super important. But if we can also do other things to try to increase that rate of adaptation. So on the right-hand side, you can see that on the bottom, on the x-axis, it's an increasing exposure to climate change. So basically we say, all right, as temperatures keep going up, on the left-hand axis, you have the level of intervention that will be needed. And on the right-hand side is like how much effort is involved. So, you know, it makes sense to try to stay down in these green areas, which is where we are already. So we've already done species protections. We've already done put in big marine protected areas, but we're finding it's not enough. What do we have in our toolbox? Well, we can do more reef restoration. We can start doing things like assisted evolution, assisted migration, and if all of those things fail, then we're left with trying to conserve species from coral reefs in things like aquaria or, you know, freezing them, cryogenics, those kind of things. So where are we right now? We're pretty much in here. We're in this sort of middle zone where we have a lot of choices about where we can go and a little bit of time to get our act together so that we can bring them to a level where they can withstand future climate change. But again, none of this is going to work unless we keep carbon emissions down. So I want to talk a little bit about this. This is kind of interesting. I put this in here because this is from The Economist. And, you know, there's a nice article about how to save the world's coral reefs, but I love the line where they say people are going to start to have to think radically. And that's just kind of funny to me to see how they have phrased that, because it's like we are starting to think radically about this, and I want to give you a few examples of what we're thinking about. And so that brings me to the third part of the talk, which is what are the innovations to increase coral reef resilience? So I want to make sure I'm going to be at the top of my slide so I can see if there are questions and answers. Okay, none yet. Okay. All right. So what can we do? I think I just skipped a slide, didn't I? I'm trying to back up here. I don't know why I can't back get here. Let me see. Okay. There's been quite a bit of discussion and ideas about what we can do to increase the resilience of reefs to climate change. There were two reports this past year by the National Academy of Sciences to go through and just sort of see what are the things we can do. They tend to fall in three categories. I already mentioned reducing carbon emissions. That's key. I put a D minus there because I don't think we've done a very good job of that, even though many people have been saying we need to reduce emissions for a long time. There's a lot of goodwill there, but it's just not happening. Reduce local stressors. That's the second thing we can do. Cleaning up the water, cleaning up coastal zones, responsible fishing. I gave it a C, and it's not because we haven't tried. I think it's just this sort of constant pressure of population and the drive for more food, needs for food, and just more human pressure. And then on the right, there's all these things we can do to try to improve and intervene with the biology and the ecosystem itself. And I'll talk about those in a little bit of detail here. Here's just some examples of those: reef restoration, managed reproduction, just a few of these ideas to put out there. There's quite a few, but these are the ones that are talked about most often. From the geoengineering side, you may be familiar with some of these things. particularly the one on the left, which is cloud brightening. And that's, you know, injecting seawater into, you know, aerosolizing it and injecting it into these existing clouds so that you can increase their reflectance and reduce the amount of sunlight reaching the Earth, at least in, on this regional basis. So there's discussion of doing that. There's a lot of problems with that, mainly because once you start it, you will have to continue it for a long time. Otherwise, as soon as you stop doing the cloud brightening, then the shock would be very high for those marine ecosystems that were used to the shading. The second thing people have tried is just put a calcium carbonate films at the water surface to reflect the sunlight. That's very local, but it could be something that helps on a few particular reefs. And then on the right-hand side is just these underwater shades. Again, that's even more local, right? So these are the kind of things that hotels and groups like that do to protect the reefs right off from, you know, for their customers. But they are things that are being discussed. If we do reef restoration, there are, it kind of looks like this. You grow corals either in situ, as in the photo at the top, or you can grow them in the lab as these corals that are being grown on ceramic discs. And you can plant those in the field. So you can see some of the corals that we've grown at the top, the raising coral Costa Rica corals that we've outplanted, or some of our colleagues' corals, fragments of hope that have see the corals growing in the wild. This works. The corals, it's really a great fun thing to do. And the whole objective is to bring reefs back to look like the ones on the right. But in reality, you can't do a lot of this. It's very intensive work. We do it mainly to just understand what needs to be done to grow corals, how to look at the genetic differences. It's really a learning process for us, but it is something that's very hard to scale up, but people are working on that as well. One thing that you might be able to scale up is something called managed reproduction. So these are people collecting eggs and sperm from corals during a spawning event. So if you can collect the eggs and sperm, this is like collecting seeds from trees or collecting pollen from trees, where you can actually create hardier species. You can increase the rate of fertilization. You can allow them to settle in the laboratory and then bring them to the field. There's a lot of ways you can manipulate this. And instead of just having the eggs and the sperm in the water column, where you have a lower probability of fertilization, lower probability of the fertilized eggs actually becoming larvae and finding suitable reef substrate, you manipulate that the way we do crops and fields. It's another picture of that. You can see the eggs being collected in a cup over an acroporid species here. It's very, very interesting work and a power of moving this out into the field in a big scalable way. But the success rates have not been super high yet. There's a lot of potential there, but it still needs development. This kind of gets us to assisted evolution, which is not exactly, you know, GMO type of stuff, but it is trying to change things about these corals to increase their resilience, sort of speed up adaptation. And one thing you can do, and people have done this, is you can change the pairing between the species of the algae that live symbiotically in their tissue and the coral animal. So you can swap those around, and they've been shown to change the resistance of those corals to bleaching. Or you can change the microbiome, just like we have a microbiome inside our guts. These have a particular type of microbiome that makes them more resilient to both temperature changes, but also diseases. So people are working a lot with that as well. What's really interesting about some of these things, really finding out a lot about how to do it. One, you know, the avenues of adaptation are, one, it's just survival. This is natural selection. If the corals make it through a bleaching event, they are the tougher ones. We're seeing that ourselves in our own restoration site. So you let nature pick the winners and you use those. That's happening already on coral reefs. Or you can acclimate them. So people are testing, how do you acclimate these corals? This is not a genetic shift. It's a change in which genes are turned on. And epigenetics tells us that sometimes those turned on genes, when they get passed on to offspring, they stay turned on. So it's not exactly a shift in the genes, but it is a shift in the resistance of the offspring. And then finally, mutations. That's just fundamental change in genetics. But a lot of what people are doing now is sort of playing around with how to create stronger species through this sort of cross fertilization during the reproductive manipulations. The second thing that, or a third thing that people are doing is something, or at least thinking about, is something called assisted migration. So we know corals live in this sort of the plot that you see, the global plot, where all the reefs are. And they live in warmer areas. The Red Sea is super warm. And there are areas around here near Japan and at higher latitudes where the waters are relatively cool. Sometimes they're the same species. So you know, you could potentially use corals from the Red Sea to help fortify some corals in some of these other areas that are cooler, and they'll stick around longer. So there's different ways to do that. But some of the, when we talk about assisted migration, it comes with different levels of risk. So typically what we do or think about doing that's not too bad is you can move corals around within an existing population. So if we look over here in the coral triangle area, and we say, okay, this is perhaps these corals here are all sharing genetic material anyway through larval dispersal and their own natural ways of crossbreeding. You could, if you lost reefs there, you could actually bring corals back into some of those damaged areas. We're sort of doing that already. You can also use them to, say, expand the range. So we know that corals are starting to move up here off of Japan and also up here along the Florida coast into Georgia. We know corals are naturally migrating into these cooler areas. So you could actually speed that up by moving corals outside of their natural range. And then the third way is sort of what I hinted at earlier, is this sort of assisted species migration where you take them out of one zone and bring them into another area where they would never occur naturally. That's a much riskier thing to do, but it's certainly not off of our map of what we might do in the future. And then the last thing, which is cryopreservation, that's not quite as desperate as it sounds. They're learning how to freeze the eggs and sperm of these corals. And if we, you know, one of the powers of this is it's a lot of risk to move corals around from one place to the other because they're going to carry things with them. They could carry disease. They could carry hitchhikers, you know, invasive species with them. And so what people do is they freeze the eggs and sperm and they can move those. So if you can take the sperm from a Red Sea coral, which is very warm, and cross, you know, to an area where you have a coral at play in the Great Barrier Reef, same species, but a cooler water coral, you might bring with that the heat tolerance of that coral with the sperm without having to bring the whole coral and cause problems with that. So the last thing I want to talk about is we can, you know, we're thinking about all of these different ways to increase the ability of corals to adapt very rapidly. But we really have to know where to do it. So not all places are equal. Oceanography is very complex around coral reefs, and how do we find the best locations for that? So there's been several initiatives to do this, something called the 50 Reefs Initiative, try to find the 50 best places in the world to try to conserve coral reefs. There's many reasons to do that, because, you know, if we know we're not going to keep all the reefs around, but we want to keep reefs around in these areas where they can, we, you know, when we stop the trajectory of increasing temperature, then these reefs can come back because we have corals in the right places where ocean currents can then help repopulate some of these regions. So I do a lot of that at NCAR, and we've focused mostly on the Western Tropical Pacific, and we use high resolution modeling. This is the regional ocean modeling system, and we've had a lot of people work with us on that. They're all listed at the bottom. It's been a very exciting thing to do, and we've learned a lot from working with these models, but they are models. So the domain is outlined in orange on this map, and all of the coral reefs are in pink. So this is a pretty interesting area. This is a picture of, again, the domain of the model. It's 5 kilometer resolution. There's a lot of specific model parameters I could talk about, but I won't bore you with all of those things. I'll talk more about the results that we've gotten. And recently we also included an even higher resolution, so a 0.5 kilometer resolution domain within that area, because we are looking for even finer and finer resolution oceanography, because it turns out that that's what's making a difference in terms of where coral reefs are surviving. So I'll talk you through some of the things we've done. This is the coral triangle outlined in the dashed line. This has been defined by Charlie Varon. We focus on this region because it is absolutely the region with the highest marine biodiversity and the highest coral diversity. There's more species of corals here than anywhere else in the world. So here we have, 700 species of corals in this region, whereas where I'm working in Costa Rica on the eastern Pacific side, we work with about 10 species of coral. So they both build reefs, but here is definitely a place worth paying attention to for future survival. We also like looking here. It's a complex oceanography. There's not many observations here. So they really need an oceanographic model to help them make decisions, but it is tough because in this bathymetric map in the ocean currents, that is a lot going on in the region. Those challenges also provide us with a lot of opportunities. So if we're looking for places where reefs can survive in the future, this is a place where we're probably going to have enough oceanographic diversity to support or have areas where that we call refugia for corals from climate change. This is an example of the output of one of these models. And this is what we call let's see if I can get it to play over here. So this is a model where we have calculated from 50 years of temperature data what the heat stress is in these regions. So this starts in 1960, it's gonna go through about 2005, something like that. On the right-hand side, you see that the purplish-blue colors are just normal. It's warm, but normal. But then you start getting into the greens, oranges, and then the pinks, and you get up to higher and higher bleaching levels. This is all done the same way we do like drought indexes. It's how much warmer the temperature is than normal, and for how long is it that warm. So we've calculated this, use this index. You'll see that over time you see the temperatures getting, or the heat stress increasing, just background. Every year we start getting more and more of this temperature stress. But you particularly see in 97, 98, that's a big El Nino and so kind of event. You'll see it really brighten up with a lot of pink and purples. And so what that does, that actually resulted in a huge mortality rates in the region. So we like to use the models to try to help us predict in the future what that heat stress is going to be, particularly and to identify those reefs where we think things are going to be better places for doing a lot of work. Let me get out of that. When we do the calculations, we also ran this into the future, the same model. So at the bottom of the graph, we look at this is the community earth system model output. We looked at 1960 versus 1980. So three 20-year segments of time compared here. On the left-hand side, that's middle of last century. That's just background levels of mild bleaching. It looks a lot like the observed record. On the middle, you see the middle of this century under the RCP 8.5 scenario. And unfortunately, this shows that, you know, almost every reef bleaches either moderately or severely every year by that time period. And then by the end of the century, it's even worse. But this one is no adaptation. If we include adaptation or a rate of adaptation, you can see that it's not as bad. There's fewer reefs that are bleaching and it's lower levels of bleaching. So this is what gives us hope, is that ability to adapt. The second thing we do is we can study how reefs recover through this reseeding and the transport of those larvae to new reefs. So this is on the left-hand side, we see coral spawning. That's a big coral head that's releasing a lot of eggs into the water column. These things tend to spawn one night out of the year, or maybe just a few nights out of the year, but always at the same time. There are exceptions, but this is the general rule. And all the eggs and sperm are all mixed up in the water column. Each species kind of times the release of its eggs and sperm so that it maximizes if those particular eggs and sperm can find each other. They tend to be buoyant, so they float to the surface. So the picture on the right shows how the wind has blown the collection of these eggs and sperm out to sea. So after a few days, usually between something like 5 to 20 days, although they can be in the water column for much, much longer and still settle, but the bulk of these things will settle out, hopefully into another reef area. So that's how coral spawning rejuvenates reefs that perhaps have been hit by coral bleaching and how they can recover. So this is just an example here. Let's see if I can get this to go. I'm not sure if you can hear it, but can you hear that?
We can, yeah.
Okay. So what you see is that we release the larvae from these reefs that are color-coded, and they mix up. You can see how these larvae move into other areas to repopulate them. So what this does is, like, we can track these larvae over time and figure out what the best places are for producing the larvae and what are the best places are for receiving the larvae, amongst many other things. And so some of the stuff that we do, see if I can get out of here. For some reason, I'm stuck. Oh, don't want that. I'm trying to find where my cursor is. Okay. So what we do is we can do something. We can calculate connectivity. So how do we follow the larvae here? So if you look at reef A, we can see that we have a lot of larvae that can be released from that reef. And then use ocean currents to figure out where those larvae are transported to. And through a bunch of calculations, we can determine what the probability of larvae remaining in transit from this reef to reach this reef. And we can do that for every grid cell that we have in the model. And we can come up with some pretty good estimates of how likely it is for these corals to be able to produce larvae that resettle on other reefs. So this is kind of the schematic of what we do. We can release the particles and track them with the velocity fields from the model. We can calculate their trajectories. We can use that to calculate their Lagrangian PDFs and then their potential connectivity. So on this side are all the source reefs. So basically there's basically like 2,500 reef sites in here. Each number represents a region. And then on the same number of reefs are down here. So if a larvae is released here, where does it end up in terms of the destination reefs? And when we do that, then we can look at the spatiotemporal patterns, the larval sources and sinks, and we can determine which of these reefs are actually most closely related to each other. And when we do that, we can say, all right, on the left-hand side, where are the reefs that produce the larvae that are most important for reseeding other reefs? So the red ones really stand out. I wouldn't trust these values here. They're too close to the model domain. But we know that larvae are released on some of these reefs, and they do end up helping out other reefs, have high connectivity. On the right, the picture looks very different. Which reefs are likely to receive larvae? Which ones are likely to be reseeded? If you look up here around Palau, these areas in here, these are isolated reefs. They mostly depend on self-seeding. They don't get a lot of larvae from other reefs, and they don't provide a lot of larvae to other reefs. Doesn't mean they're not important. It just means that you don't get a lot of geographic expansion of those corals. We can also look at subpopulations. So we say, all right, which ones are most closely related? So all the Great Barrier Reef corals cluster together. All of the ones here in the central part and so on. That's important when you're planning restoration or planning some of these conservation activities, because you want to know how closely these are related if you're going to migrate corals around or whatever you're going to do. And then on the right-hand side, what you see is that even though some of these populations are very closely linked through connectivity, they can have really different temperature patterns. That's also good. That probably means that those corals have a wide range of genetic tolerances for temperature change. And so, for example, if you take this reef here on the Great Barrier Reef, we can go in and look at that particular reef and we could say, where do all its larvae come from? If that reef were to be wiped out, most of them are going to come from down here. Unfortunately, if that's true, these are cooler waters on the Great Barrier Reef than here. That means that that reef is going to get larvae from corals that are cooler. Whereas if we had a reef in another location that are getting larvae from reefs that are warmer, they may be getting larvae that are pre-adapted to higher temperature change. So when temperature changes in those regions, they'll be more adapted already to climate change versus a reef that's getting all of its larvae from cooler waters. So we're trying to calculate and put all these things in as factors as to where the best reefs are. In fact, we can actually look at what are the benefits of where you get your larvae from. So what this map shows is that if you are in the red, if you are a reef with a high red color, it means your temperature tolerance is probably warmer than it would be if you were not receiving larvae from warmer areas, and vice versa. Unfortunately, the Great Barrier Reef has a lower temperature threshold based on the fact that the larvae are typically transported from cooler regions to into warmer regions. So we have just some tricks that we're trying to figure out how to do this. The last thing I'll quickly talk about is internal tides. So the whole time I've been at NCAR for a couple decades now and looking at how we can use models to help us make decisions about coral reefs and coral reef conservation, the large scale models just don't work very well because they're too coarse for the scale of coral reefs. But as we get finer and finer resolution and we have more computer power, we can see things that we've not been able to see before with these models, and they can be key. So we know that even in some areas where there are coral reefs bleaching, there typically are a few places where they don't. And we know it has to do with some sort of local oceanographic condition, probably more than anything. And we'd like to find those. So now we're looking at something called internal tides. These are a lot like waves, surface waves on the surface of the ocean, but they occur under, beneath the ocean. You don't see them typically, but they occur under the ocean between areas where we have low density water, the surface warm waters, and deeper high density waters. So the wave, if a wave is triggered, it will propagate along that particular surface, typically something like a thermocline. So people know that these have occurred. There's been a lot of work, particularly in this area in the South China Sea called Dongsha Atoll. People have actually been able to measure those and see that the reefs that experience or that are influenced by these internal waves or internal tides, they do much better during bleaching events. And we see another example here. This is a temperature trace on an area which is sheltered from internal waves and an area that receives internal waves on the exposed side. The areas that receive those internal waves did much better because they're getting cooler water mixed up and they don't bleach, whereas these on the left do bleach. So Scott Bachman is a scientist at NCAR that's begun working on this, and he uses a lot of very interesting numerical techniques. Again, we're looking in the center part here, and it's rotated, so it might be kind of hard to, you know, orient yourself. But this is like a 500 meter grit scale, and I'll just show this video here, because what you see is this is sort of the sea surface temperature. Something obviously is going on to affect the sort of surface temperature patterns. And when you look underneath, when it switches over to the solitary waves, you can see this is basically the tide impacting or interacting with the bathymetry to produce these waves. These are the solitary waves that we are referring to as internal tides. And they can have a big impact when they reach a coral reef, like in this video here, where I can find it, where you can see on the left-hand side of that peak, the water is being pushed up that slope, and it's cooler water. And so those internal waves are actually causing or allowing any kind of reef on that side to experience enough cooling that it can survive during a bleaching event. And so when we look at this in the coral triangle region, the key is to have both the impacts of this tidal energy causing these waves, these internal waves to propagate, but also to have a source of deep cool water nearby. And so this complex bathymetry in the coral triangle is very interesting because it provides both of those conditions. And so when we have that, we can see that we can produce these areas in the red boxes, which we think are natural thermal refugia. And actually, it's exciting. We haven't been able to verify it yet. We need a little bit more field data. But in areas like this, this is an area where the reefs are pretty much don't know that bleaching is going on very much. They really are healthy, really high percent coral cover. And it's been a little bit of a mystery, but we think that what's causing these reefs to survive is that they have these, you know, very fine scale oceanographic features affecting them. So I'm going to recap here so that we have time for questions. But the fact is the coral reefs are already declining rapidly. We know that. And so we're trying to find ways that we can keep them around. We have about 20 to 30 years before we reach that sort of peak value. Again, I like to call that, you know, flattening the curve. The faster we can do that, the fewer reefs we will lose. So reducing carbon emissions is imperative, but it's not enough. If we just did that, it's still not enough. We have to go in and take some interventions and some actions to ensure the coral reefs can come back more quickly. But we have to do it in the right places, and that's where the modeling comes in. So I want to thank you guys for putting up with my rather long talk, but I hope you found some nuggets of interesting information in there, and thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much, Joanie. And if you have some questions, please use the Q&A feature on Zoom. And
I don't have any questions to answer yet. Some. I may have lost them all.
There's
what
one.
Other effects? That's a good question. So the question that Devin has asked is, what other effects on local ecosystems will occur if coral reefs go extinct? Well, they're very important ecosystems. So ecologically, they support, what is the number? I think it's 30% of all marine fish species spend some time of their life cycle on coral reefs. A lot of the world's food supply in terms of marine protein comes from coral reefs. The reefs are so biodiverse is because they grow into these massive, large calcium carbonate structures that provides a lot of different spaces of different sizes that can support a high biodiversity of organisms. And they also protect shorelines. So when, there's already evidence that when reefs are removed for whatever reason, the shorelines that they protect begin to erode. And so there's a lot of interest by coastal developers to have reefs regrown in front of some of these areas to protect the shorelines and their property. So there's a lot of things. We could go on and on about that alone. The next question is, how is managing coral reproduction different from the equivalent process for crop breeding? That's a great question. I'd say it's not that different, except that we have many species of coral, hundreds of species of corals that we would like to keep around, and we don't have that many resources to work in the reproductive sense with all those. So that is a tough one, but it's corals are animals versus plants, so that's one issue. We've only just started doing this, so we're kind of behind the curve in terms of learning how to increase the fertilization rates and then how to make sure that, when you plant seeds, you kind of expect which ones are going to survive. But right now for corals, we can produce a lot of these larvae and we can actually settle them, not we, but my colleagues, settle them onto surfaces and then bring them out into the field, but it's still hard to get those survival rates up. So that's the big difference. We're still trying to figure that out. It's like we're, missing some sort of secret ingredient. The next question is, which innovative practice has been the most successful? Whoa, that's a really good one. Personally, I'm working on reef restoration. And that is basically, we're just using fragmentation. We break a coral, you can grow it really fast. So like, I don't know if you can see this, but this is an example of one of the corals I use. If you can take a little piece of that coral and we can, you could take this whole coral and you could produce hundreds of corals out of it. But it's genetically all the same, they're clones. So you don't wanna do that. You wanna have a lot of different diversity when you do that. It's successful because we know we can replant a lot of reefs. It's not successful in terms of, is it ecologically sound? Do we have enough diversity? Are we ensuring the genetic diversity? And the key to success is that reef, once we plant it, is it self-sustaining? Is it reproducing on its own? Is it starting to behave like a reef? But that is sort of the backbone for all of these other things. So reason we do restoration is to sort of figure out how to implement some of these new innovations in the field really quickly. So if we can learn how to put a reef back together, so to speak, when we do have ways to do adaptation, learn how to how to push corals or to crossbreed them to be stronger, then we can put that very quickly into the restoration process. So again, we're sort of at the cutting edge of this thing. The last question from Caitlin is, are there species which might be able to fill in for coral reefs after they experience these bleaching events? Well, not in the short term, I would say. I mean, in the past, in the geologic past, there have always been some sort of reefs, but the players have changed, the species have changed. So even around the time of the dinosaurs, the main reef builders were these big bivalves. But corals, be very hard to replace them ecologically with something else these days, or rapidly enough. And then the second thing is, are there synthetic alternatives we could create instead? There's not synthetic species, but there are synthetic reef materials that people are producing that actually encourage reef growth much more quickly. So there are ways to do that. Most reef scientists don't go there because it's has not been as successful as natural reef rock, and it hasn't been as cheap. But it is something that we all investigate. You know, we're keeping an open mind about all these things. Okay, let's see if there's anything else. Oh my God, there's a ton. If you study coral, you just cut me off when I'm done.
Okay. We have about 10 more minutes, I think, if that works for you.
Shall I just keep going?
Sure, if that's okay, that would be great. Yeah.
You have good students. These are really good questions. Have you done any estimates as to how many fish we would lose? Because I've seen numbers where 25% depend on coral reefs at some point in their lives. Yeah. Well, if you don't have a reef structure anymore, you're definitely going to lose all of the fish. Because that's what they're attracted to, almost all of the fish. People have done studies of that in 87, 88 in the Galapagos region. The reefs all almost completely died during a bleaching event. And then the whole coral reef just disappeared. It was eroded away in a matter of years by things like sea urchins. And so Peter Glenn from University of Miami, I think he's done some biodiversity studies. I don't know specifically fish, but certainly biodiversity, and definitely the biodiversity went down. So losing the corals is one thing, but when you lose the reef structure, it's another level altogether. How far in the development process are most reef intervention solutions, and what could be done to speed up their implementation? So we're actually working on a paper on that right now. You can look at this National Academy Science Report, and they try to evaluate that. So I can't go through each one. But the genetic studies in coral reefs has gone up a lot. And with that power of understanding the genetics, and people are doing more to try to understand how much that can be used in terms of reproduction, you know, this sort of assisted reproduction strategies and that sort of thing. But basically, a lot of these things are new. So whereas when we've been in forest for a long time, trying to study how to do reforestation or better crops, most of our attitude about coral reefs is to leave them alone. You don't mess around with them. You put them, you know, you can put a marine protected area around them, but don't move them around, don't touch them. So that's all changed now. And so the innovations are coming very fast, very quickly, but they haven't been proven. And so that's part of the process. To speed up the implementation, I didn't talk about this very much, but we need a lot of policy to help us do that. We need money, we need policy. And I'll give you an example of how I think, or a metaphor of how I think about this. People often say that when you want to save coral reefs, it's like sending a man to the moon, right? Well, that was a technological feat more than anything. And money and organization and everything else. We could try to model after that, but it's not simply technological, it's biological and ecological. So it's more like the war on cancer, which we know is another one of these huge global campaigns to beat a disease, but it takes, there's a lot more uncertainty involved, and it takes a lot of more trial and error and a lot more control of risk when you do that. And so thinking about it along those terms, it's kind of, you're in it for the long haul. You know you're going to have successes along the way, but they're not going to be like a, you know, there, we did it. It's always going to be improving our techniques as we go. And some of these questions I don't think I'm going to know the answer to, but it says, has genetic editing been considered to activate dormant genes and cause mutations that could boost resilience? That's a good question. So people have done, I think maybe have tried a little bit of that, either with the coral or with the algae that live within the coral. But again, it's one of these tricky manipulations that has a lot of risk carried with it. So it would take a long time to put something like that online. But I know people are looking at some of those methodologies, but not that many. So if that's what you want to do for your career, go for it. Are there other biological organisms that serve a similar role to coral reefs? That's similar to the question I answered before. Finding something that can replace a coral is really hard. It is such a foundational species. It's like, can you replace a tree? We can replace some corals with other corals, but we probably can't replace a coral with something like a clam. It's just the functional role that coral plays is so diverse. It would be super difficult. And I know you had a woman speaking about one of your first talks was Amanda Rodewald talking about how difficult it is to predict these ecosystems. It's not just one species. It's how these species move with each or without each other and what their different tolerances are. It's very, very challenging. Is there a significant impact of plastic pollution, plastic contamination when plastic chemicals leach into the water on coral reefs? Plastics are a problem everywhere. For corals, even the little micro bits of plastic can be ingested by the coral. So the corals feed the same way anemones do. And when they ingest, sometimes for some reason, they like to ingest these little plastic particles. There must be a microfilm on them or something that makes them tasty. But we don't know what the effects are on the coral yet. We just find plastic bits inside the coral. The chemicals that leach into the water, I don't know. I tell you the truth, I don't know the answer. I know that some sunscreens have problems for coral, cause problems for coral reefs. But I don't know about the leaching of plastics. That is a good question. You stumped me on that one. And let's see if I can move this up. Okay. Why are coral reefs in the Pacific so much more diverse? Oh, wow, that's a good one. Is there a way to introduce more biodiversity into less diverse reefs? Well, I wish we could do that. It's one of the theories, one of the hypotheses as to why the Caribbean reefs are doing so much more poorly than the ones in the Pacific. In the Pacific, you have so many species, we have something called niche replication. So if you wipe out one species of coral, there's several other species of corals that can fill that niche. In the Caribbean, you have fewer degrees of freedom. You wipe out one, all of a sudden, boom, you don't have anybody else take that role. That's what happened with the die-off of the sea urchins. In the Caribbean, the diadema, is it was a big grazer on the reef, so it kept the algae down. And as soon as you knock that coral, that diadema out, that sea urchin, then the corals became covered with algae. And so when you couple that with overfishing, which also took away the other algae eaters, the things that control the algae, the reefs flipped. They just stopped becoming reefs and they turned into these algal mounds. So we know that how important this niche replication is on reefs, but I don't think people are figuring out how to, or even entertaining the idea of saying increasing biodiversity on a less diverse reef. That's because invasive species is such a problem. If we start from scratch, if we lose everything and we start from scratch, it'd probably be okay to do that, but it's not an accepted idea right now to do that because there's such a problem with invasive species. And then the last question, I believe, is what can policy government do to help the harm done to coral reefs? Well, main thing they can do is to put in policies to reduce the carbon emissions, because that is the number one problem we have right now. And the second thing they can do is to help us develop policies that make it easier to test some of these interventions and to build coalitions amongst people. Right now we see with the pandemic that one of the difficult things is that there's people all over the place trying to develop vaccines. If they don't do that in a coordinated fashion, there's a lot of duplication of effort and a lot of lost time. But if you do it in a coordinated fashion, you can speed up the process. And so that's another thing that they can help us with. So I've talked a lot. I'm sorry I've talked so much, but I really love your questions. I wish I could hear them in person.
So thank you so much for coming and talking to us, Joanie, today. It's a fascinating seminar. And hopefully we can get you here in person sometime.
I hope so. And I appreciate your attention, and everybody stay safe out there and stay positive. I don't want this to be too depressing. What I want to say is we can do this if we have this in this 20, 30 year period of time, and we can be an example for many other ecosystems as well. So keep your thinking caps on. I loved your questions, and we can try to incorporate some of those into our future thinking.
Thank you again.
Thank you.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye.